All right, now we're joined by Kathy Moore, who's running for Superior Court Position 44. So go ahead with a two-minute introduction.
Okay. Well, good evening. Thank you very much, everyone, for spending your long evening hours doing this. I've been through candidate evaluation processes on your side, and it's hard work, so I very much appreciate your time. I'm running for King County Superior Court because I have spent the bulk of my legal career and also my civic engagement in working towards access to justice and equal justice. I feel very strongly that access to justice and the type of justice that people receive should not be based on external factors such as race, gender, financial circumstances, sexual orientation. I started out as a public defender, providing access to justice by providing legal counsel to people who could not afford counsel. I have spent a lot of time providing pro bono services to people when I no longer worked as a public defender. I was elected to the Washington State Bar Association Board of Governors, and a lot of the work that we did there was on securing funding for civil legal aid. I was on the board in 2008 and 2009 during the recession, and Northwest Justice Project was looking at having to shut down many of its clinics statewide. I and another governor came up with an idea of giving $1 million plus to the Legal Aid Foundation to ensure that Northwest Justice could continue to provide the same level of legal services. I also conceptualized a new revenue stream for civil legal aid that has raised about $1 million since then. After serving on the Board of Governors, I served as a chair of the Seattle Human Rights Commission, and there I attempted to expand the definition of the rights that are available to the citizens of Seattle, and I want to continue that level of work as a King County Superior Court judge.
Great, thank you. So now we have our four prepared questions, and I think our last interview we left them in front. If you want to turn the sheet of paper over, hopefully it says Superior Court at the top. These are two-minute answers, and Josh, will you do number one?
Yeah. Like the rest of the government, the courts have struggled with reductions in funding. Where can the courts cut costs and increase efficiency, and how will you advocate for sufficient funding of our judicial branch?
I think I'm going to start with the second part of the question first, because sometimes it's easier. In terms of advocating for sufficient funding, I think that the biggest piece of that is public education. Too many people do not know how our courts are funded, and too many people do not understand the work that the King County Superior Court does. And the work of the King County Superior Court pretty much touches the lives of everybody in one way or another. And so I think it's important for the judiciary, members of the judiciary, to go out to community meetings, legislative districts, really be visible in the community, talking about the work of the court and where our funding sources come from, and to get people to advocate to their state legislature that they need to start providing sufficient funding for the courts, at least 50% funding for courts. In terms of how the court can cut costs and increase efficiency, I know that the court has implemented customer satisfaction surveys and looking at what people feel is working with the system and what is not working. I think continuing to look at that data is helpful. Trying to use database practices to determine where efficiencies can be made. I know in terms of the looking at processing of cases that they've been talking about, trying to make sure that people stay on schedule when the case is scheduled, that they monitor the progress of litigation to make sure it's moving along at the right pace, and that hearings start when they're supposed to start. So I think a lot of it is about being mindful as a judge in your own courtroom that you are using your time efficiently, and then also to take that data to the broader goal of how the court itself is working.
Great. Jason, number two.
How do you define judicial temperament?
I think the most important characteristics of judicial temperament are somebody who is fair and impartial, somebody who is patient and compassionate, somebody who recognizes that the decisions that they are making have an impact on the lives of the people who come before them. And there's a concept out there of procedural fairness, and that idea is that for many people, it does matter whether they win or lose, but ultimately what's more important is that they felt that they were heard through the process, and that their concerns were given due consideration, and that there was some sense of validity to what they had to say to the court. And so I think as judicial temperament, you need to be able to be patient, to have an open mind, and to be able to explain clearly to individuals why you're making the decision that you're making, and to remain calm. A lot of the work that I did as a pro tem in the Regional Justice Center in Kent, I dealt with a lot of pro se's, and I also, as an administrative law judge, pretty much everybody is pro se. So it's very important to remember when you're dealing with pro se that it's a foreign system, and to try to help people walk through that process, and to remain patient with people, because often they're confused about how the court works, and many times issues are very emotional for them, and to recognize that emotion and to help them calmly work through what the steps are to get to a fair and just resolution of their conflict.
Elizabeth, number three.
Please tell us about the types of community service you do and the professional and public organizations you've been involved with over the past 10 years.
I have a variety of community service that I have been involved in over the years. Most recently, as I said, I chaired the Seattle Human Rights Commission. Prior to serving as the chair, I was a commissioner for a year. Prior to my service there, I served on the Washington State Bar Association Board of Governors, which is the policy-making body for the all the 43,000-plus lawyers in the state of Washington. I've served on the King County Municipal Candidate Evaluation Committees, both for the school board, for legislative uses, for judicial uses. I've served as on the Legal Voice Legislative Committee. I've also served in the Family Law Clinic at RUA. So I've done both sort of bar work as well as community work. I was at CASA and at GAL for a time. I spent a lot of time, three children, two of whom are now out of the home, but I spent a lot of time volunteering in their schools and volunteering with the PTSA. And I've been also very interested. I was elected as a PCO for the 34th and 46th districts. So as a PCO, I did a fair amount of rebelling and handing out materials. And I've continued to remain involved in my legislative district, and volunteered on a number of judicial, legislative, and presidential campaigns. So I'm interested and also in voter registration efforts.
Okay. What's number four?
Do you support the current system of electing judges, or do you support some other system, such as appointment or an appointment and retention election hybrid?
I adamantly support the election of judges. It's a controversial issue, particularly within the legal profession. A lot of lawyers and judges feel that judges should be elected. I believe that anybody who has authority over someone else's life in such a capacity needs to be accountable to the public at some level. I know people say, well, you can get that through a retention system. The problem with retention is that you run up against the benefit of incumbency. Even when people are not necessarily doing a good job on the bench, people are reluctant to unelect them, and people are reluctant to run against them, you know, because people tend to come to the support of their friends, so people circle the wagons. And lawyers don't want to jeopardize potential relationships or businesses, so I don't see retention systems as really an effective mechanism to keeping judges accountable. I think, though, that if you are going to have an election system such as we have, that it's very important to provide educational efforts about what judges do and what people should be looking for in the judge. The League of Women Voters does a good job of that. The Municipal League does a good job of that. Our associations, to some extent, although each of them have a particular agenda, comes into play. So. I know there's been concern about the money affecting elections of judges and judges feeling that they have to make a particular ruling because of political pressure. I think that that issue has come into play more at the higher level when you're looking at Supreme Court races than at the lower level. But I would also say that even when you are appointing judges, there is a particular, people come from an establishment, so there's more of an internal network that comes into play with appointment of judges isn't necessarily there in the election of judges.
So now we'll open it up to follow-up questions. These are one-minute answers. Josh?
Your slogan is justice for all. So when you have litigants in front of you, how do you personally, when you're, you know, as a judge, ensure that that anybody, you know, you're any case you're rolling on, any litigant you're in front of you, is that you're, you know, basically dealing with them justly and equitably and fairly?
Well, in the past when I've served as a judge, you know, I have always given both sides equal time. I've always listened to the arguments of both sides. If I have felt that, you know, sometimes after a heavy calendar, you might come in and people are being difficult, if I feel the need, I'll step off the bench to regain my composure or my sense of equanimity. But I think really the main thing is just to recognize I have been, you know, I've personally experienced the legal system, and it is an intimidating process. And I think it's important to remember that the people out there are just like I am when I'm not wearing a robe, and to provide them the respect and courtesy. And also to continue to educate myself about, you know, what particular biases might come into play, and to check those as well.
Any additional questions?
Jason? How do you differentiate justice and retribution?
Well, I think retribution is an emotional response to an injury that's been suffered personally by an individual as a victim, or by society through some horrific act that has happened that has touched society. And I think it tends to be sort of the first response that people have, and it's sort of the amygdala response. Justice, in my opinion, is a more reasoned, considered, and I guess you would say rational response to trying to address the harm that has occurred while also trying to protect the individual or society from being re-victimized or additional harm happening without losing sight of the fact that emotion is involved. And people are involved.
All right. Yeah, Elizabeth, and then I have one.
So here in your literature, it mentions that you successfully procured $1 million plus in emergency funds for the People Foundation. Can you tell us more about that?
Yes, absolutely. So, as as I mentioned, I was serving on the Board of Governors in 2008, and at that time, the IOLTA funding had taken a serious hit because of the economy. The Legal Foundation had come to the Bar Association and asked for help. The president of the bar at that time had wanted to basically raise the bar dues that lawyers pay and use part of that money to give to the Legal Foundation. Many of us on the board felt that would be very unpopular. There's always a fight about our dues. So another governor and I sat down and we looked at the Washington State Bar Association's budget and took a very careful look at their reserve funding. And they had many different sources of reserves. And there was one reserve in particular that had about $1 million. It was just sitting there. It had been there for many years. There was not designated for any particular purpose. And so it was our proposal. It was somewhat of a redistributive approach, but it was our opinion that it was the money in the membership. The membership had paid those dues. And as leaders of the association, it was our responsibility to use that money wisely. And so we put together a proposal to give that money to the Legal Aid Foundation, to the Legal Foundation of Washington.
Great. So question, and then your time, Liz Campbell, will go next. So you're running in a race with a couple other candidates. One of them has not responded to my emails, but we did interview Eric Newman. So I was wondering if you could explain specifically why you would be a better candidate for Superior Court than Eric Newman would be.
Well, I'm sure that Eric Newman is a very fine person, and I've looked at his website, and he's done a lot of work, and so I have a lot of regard for what he's done for his community. And he's also a veteran from the Air Force, and I also appreciate his service in that regard. But I think that I'm a better candidate because I think that the challenges facing our court right now revolve around recognizing institutional racism, implicit bias, and racial disproportionality, and how that has an impact on justice all the way up from juvenile court all the way through adult court, for lack of a better term. But those are really the compelling issues of our day. And also access to justice and making justice equal remain compelling issues. And I think that my literature shows that I do have 25 plus years of actually being in the trenches, providing legal representation, not providing legal representation, working on committees that are working to remove barriers to justice, and working in other commissions, like the Human Rights Commission, to broaden the definition. We worked on the box legislation. The commission was invaluable in creating that, which ends, helps with re-employment for people who are re-entering after serving their time.
So Liz, last question.
I was interested in your literature that you advocated for an independent civilian review board with subpoena power to review police misconduct. And I was wondering if you could tell me a little bit about that board as you envisioned it and how that went and how you would have envisioned an empowered, very functional review board.
Well, I want to say that I advocated for that in my role as chair of the Human Rights Commission. It didn't go over well, honestly. There was a lot of pushback about having an independent review board with subpoena power. This happened around the time that the consent decree was put into place. The Community Police Commission managed to become a very active voice in police reform. And we have a monitoring team. And I, the commission felt that the recommendations that the Community Police Commission were making, they made about 26, I think at one point they made 50 odd recommendations. Many of them were very, very good recommendations. I think ultimately the commission felt that without an independent review board, you were always going to wind up sort of with the cult of personality. Did you happen to have a really good police chief? At the moment, we happen to have a really good chief of police. But we have to have institutional protections so that it doesn't matter. So whenever somebody leaves, you continue to have that review. And we felt that as long as the ultimate disciplinary decisions were left to the chief, that it could potentially be a political issue. And that again, you needed to make sure that there was an institutional way to ensure that discipline did not appear to be biased or unfair. And so the model that we really looked at was the San Francisco model. That was the one that we felt would be most effective. Personally, I think that it's going to take an initiative for that to happen, but there are many, many committed and well-meaning individuals working on this issue.
So we're out of time. If you want to take just 30 seconds for a closing statement.
Well, again, thank you very much for giving me this time. I am in a contested race, but I do believe that my record shows that if elected to the bench, I will be committed to equal justice and access to justice. I've done a lot of work in the legal community on those issues. A lot of experience in committee work where a lot of this change happens incrementally, and I would like to continue to do that work. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much.